Hey everyone, welcome to my video series on the most downloaded Flipper Zero apps from lab.flipper.net, which is the official app store for the Flipper Zero. In this video, we'll be looking at 20 apps, starting from the 30th most popular app. And if you want to start the playlist at 100, go ahead and click here. At the end of each video is a list of the applications. So if you just want to see the list, jump to the end of each video for that list. Let's get started. Number 30, DTMF Dolphin. You can use the dialer to send keypad. Or you can use the blue box if it's the 1960s and you've got that Captain Crunch tones. And you can generate tones like payphones did when you insert money. I doubt signaling works this way anymore, but only use this on devices you own. Number 29, mass storage. Go down to the new image option, choose your size, and then type in the name of an image. This will create a file on your Flipper Zero. And that file will be an image that can be attached to your computer. So we just made a 4 meg drive. And then you can go to select disk image and choose any of the image files you've created. Again, the Flipper Zero is a fairly slow device, but when we plug it in, you'll see that data received and transmitted. And there are our folders on our portable drive. Number 28, Genie Door Recorder. This application uses the GPIO pins to transfer all of the codes from your Genie brand garage door remote. I cover this application in detail in video 87. Once you've learned enough codes, you can go to send and then press OK to open your garage door. In this video, I'm just using a fan connected to the Genie receiver. Number 27, resistance calculator. Select the number of bars on your resistor. In this case, I have 4. And my resistor is orange, and then orange, and then black, and then gold. And so we can see that resistance is 33 ohms with a 5% tolerance. Number 26, ESP Flasher. This application lets you enter your bootloader for your ESP32, and you should see a waiting for download message. And then you're able to go to flash ESP. If you have an S3, you can choose that. Otherwise, select your bootloader, select your partition table, and select your firmware A that you want to use on your ESP32. And then you can choose flash fast or flash slow. Start with fast, and if it doesn't work, go down to slow. There's lots of ESP32 firmwares such as Marauder, Ghost ESP, Flipper HTTP, Gemini IA, and more. And I cover many of these firmwares in my other videos. If you're using custom firmware, there may be an option to quick flash, which will save you from having to select each of the files. Number 25, Mifare Fuzzer. Choose the type of card, such as classic 1K, 4K, or ultralight. In my case, I'll go ahead and do 4K. And then you can choose between test values, random values, or load the IDs from file. In my case, I'll choose test values. And then we can change the speed of each value. And we'll go ahead and do start. Only test this on devices you own. You're probably going to cause log files if you've hooked up your reader properly. And what we're trying to do in fuzzing is see if there's any combination of numbers that causes an unexpected response from our reader. Number 24, POCSAG Pager. This application receives messages on sub-gigahertz frequencies. I'm on 43392. And we can see some messages coming in that are alerts. And then there's a message that says hi. And then if we click on it, we can see the full details. Number 23, multi-converter. Select the pound sign to choose your conversion. And then use the arrow keys to choose what to convert from. You can see there's temperature, distances, degrees, and numbers. So we'll go ahead and do Celsius, and we'll convert it to Fahrenheit. And so 23 Celsius is 73 Fahrenheit. Number 22, MFKey. This application will try to calculate the missing keys for the Mifare Classic card that you own. Once the keys have been found, they'll be saved in your user key dictionary so that next time you read the card, you'll successfully get the information. Number 21, Sub-GHz Remote. With this application, you're able to connect up to 5 different sub-GHz signals to your Flipper Zero. Here you can see I'm able to turn on and off the light. In the edit map file, you can open your map file and then choose the mapping for the D-pad on the Flipper Zero for which label and which file it will use to play. Again, I recommend only controlling devices that you own. Don't do the CVS or the Walgreens unless you have permission in that store. Number 20. iButton Fuzzer. Choose the iButton protocol, such as DS1990. And then choose if you want to use the default values, load from a file, or load IDs from a file. In my case, I'll just go ahead and say default values. And then you can choose the time delay between the signals. Go ahead and do 0.4. And then we can choose the emulation time or how long the signal is being sent. And here we are trying different codes. And our reader is now in an unexpected state. Number 19, NFC Maker. Choose the type of NFC tag you want to create, such as phone numbers, text notes, Wi-Fi URLs, Bluetooth, and contact card. I'll just do an HTTPS link. And then we're able to type in our URL. And in the bottom left, you can see we switch between letters and symbols. Next, choose the type of tag. For example, an NTAG 213 would be good to emulate on your cell phone. You can see there's all kinds of choices. I'm going to go ahead and use a Mifare Classic 1K. With a 4-byte UID. We can change that UID if we want. And then we can go ahead and name our tag. And this will save your tag as a .nfc file. Number 18, EM4100 Key Generator. Select an existing EM4100 file, and you'll get a generated.txt in the RFID Fuzzer directory. You can then use these generated.txt IDs with an RFID Fuzzer app. Number 17, FindMy Flipper. This application supports a variety of protocols such as Apple AirTag, Samsung SmartTag, Tile, and Google. In my case, I'm using the AirTag, and on my phone, we're able to see where I left my Flipper Zero. Huge thanks to Talking Sasquatch for his video on how to set up the Find My Flipper app. Number 16, RFID Fuzzer. This application supports a wide variety of RFID protocols. I'll go ahead and use the EM4100 protocol. And then you can choose default values, byte field customer ID, where all the rest of the bytes will be zero. Load from file. I'll go ahead and do a quick demo of that. We'll pick the mic EM4100. We can change the current value, and then we can choose which byte we want to iterate. So right now I have A3, and then the 3-4 is the byte we want to iterate. So when I go ahead and we can change our timing and our emulation time, how long each signal is, and you'll see that that section is incrementing. Again, like all these fuzzing applications, only test on hardware you own, because you may put the hardware in an unexpected state. And then we have load UIDs from file, and I'll go ahead and select that generated.txt that we created from the EM4100 key generator. Number 15, XRemote. You can learn new remotes, load saved remotes, and analyze signals. I'll show the learn process for how we learn a new remote. So it says press power button on the remote. Make sure that you're pointing towards the IR sensor. And there it is. And then we click on next. And now we press the setup button. And there it is. And then say next. And just proceed through each of the buttons. Input in my case is called source. And if you don't have a button, you can also just click to the right and do skip. Once you've gone through all of the buttons or chose finish, you'll be asked to name your new remote. And then we can go ahead and hit save. And if you go into saved and select one of your remote files, then you'll see that there's these different categories of signals. So we have general, which has things like our input and power setup, that kind of stuff. And then control, which is our volume and channels and mute. Navigation, which is the arrow keys and the OK button. And then playback, which is our pause, fast forward, rewind. And then finally in edit, you can choose what the custom buttons do. And then in custom is whatever you've defined. Number 14, Seader. Unfortunately, I don't have the hardware to demonstrate this application, but Iceman's channel has a video walking through how to use the application. This application allows you to read an HID card and save it in different formats for a downgrade attack. Again, only test on hardware you own. Number 13, NFC Magic. With this application, you can check to see if a card supports Magic Tag. In this case, this card does not support the Magic Tag, so nothing is going to happen. It just says apply card to the back. And then when I switch to another card that does support the Magic Tag, and we do check Magic Tag, you can see it says Magic Card Detected, type Gen 1A/B. Then we can go ahead and click on more, and we can write to the tag, wipe the card, or dump the file that's currently on the tag. We'll go ahead and do a dump and save that. So we have a backup of whatever data was on our tag. And then we have to do check for tag, more, and now we can do that write. I'll go ahead and select my YouTube that we created using the NFC Maker app. But you could choose any Mifare Classic file. Now that we've programmed that tag, we can read it with our phone and go ahead and just open the link. And there's the YouTube channel. Number 12, PicoPass. This application allows you to read various iClass cards. I'll go ahead and read this card. And you can see it says SE enabled. And in the bottom of the card, you can see it does say SE. So for this card, you'd be better off using the Seader application. I'll go ahead and try to read an iClass card that does not have SE, and this time we were able to read the data. We'll go ahead and click on more, and you can see that we can save that file that we captured from our card. There it is saved. And we can also save it as a low frequency RFID credential, which we can then write to a RFID card. And if you own the reader, you can try a low class attack on your hardware. And number 11, FlipWiFi. FlipWiFi allows us to scan for access points. We need an ESP32 connected that has our Flipper HTTP firmware flashed on it. I'll go ahead and select my Wi-Fi and say add, and then type in the password for my Wi-Fi. And now that is a saved access point. If we click on set, then it will use that access point for all of the Flipper HTTP applications. Here's the list of applications that will now use that access point. FlipWiFi also has other features such as deauthentication, captive portal, and running commands to your ESP32. Only do deauthentication on your own network. Please like and subscribe. And this has just been a brief overview of the applications. If you want any in-depth information, please leave a comment on which application you'd like me to cover.